This is Geektastic Weekly for the weeks of August 7th, 2015. Windows 10, 2 weeks later.
I believe we're already at episode 3.
Episode 3?
Yeah. Episode 3 already.
Round 3.
Yep. Yeah, welcome to your show that is just two geeks just sitting around talking about gaming, tech, and entertainment.
Geeky.
So, let's get to the news. Start off, big changes coming for Destiny on the PS4. The Taken King expansion is coming, the first big expansion for Bungie's somewhat disappointing, but also somewhat still successful hybrid MMO first-person shooter is getting ready to release, and they're going to replace Peter Dinklage as the voice of the ghost. Replace.
I'm trying to find out what that word meant. Replace. Can you please define that one? It was a new word for me.
They're going to replace Peter. They're going to replace Peter Dinklage,
okay,
who sort of phoned in his performance as the ghost, which is your little AI companion in the game, with Nolan North, who is basically game voiceover god. He's sort of the man to go to whenever you need any voiceover work for games.
You have any examples of who we might... Some people who may not be familiar with him, you have any example where they might have heard him?
Oh, God, he's been in so many games I couldn't list them all.
Well, just give one or two examples, for example.
Oh, jeez. Oh, he's been in the Uncharted games... I think he's been in Assassin's Creed a few times. Oh, jeez. Mostly a lot of console titles.
Okay.
I don't know all of them off the top of my head, but he's been in a lot.
He's made his way around.
He's like the Vic Mignogna of video games.
Okay.
Vic's been in a lot of anime. He's the voice of Edward Elric.
Oh, I know that one.
Yeah, he's like him. He's the top guy to go to when it comes to gaming voices. He's got a wide range. And there's my phone again. Forget to turn that thing off. But, yeah, he's being replaced. He's replacing Peter Dinklage. They're not changing the dialogue of Ghost. They're just having him re-record it.
And he's going to re-record all of it?
Yeah, he's going to re-record all of Peter Dinklage's role in the game.
Huh.
Yeah.
Because I know in Final Fantasy, when they added in a bunch of new voices, if you go back and listen to the earlier cutscenes, you have the original voices, so they didn't go back and re-record anything. So in this case, you're saying, no, they actually went back and redid all of the other voices.
Right? Yeah, they liked him so much better than Peter Dinklage. I mean,
wow.
Peter Dinklage is not a bad actor. It's just, I've never played the game, but I've seen videos.
Mm-hmm.
And he phoned in his performance.
Like, okay, here's your stuff, I'm done, I'm out of here.
I mean, he sounded boring and lifeless. I mean, he was pretty good in Pixels. And he's pretty darn good in Game of Thrones.
No. This one was
the midget.
The midget.
Okay. Yeah. He's really good in Game of Thrones, really good in Pixels.
Yeah, I actually like his work. I've seen several in a number of movies. I think X-Men, I think, had him.
Days of Future mm-hmm. Past. He was in that.
He's a good actor.
He's a good actor, but he was he was not that great in Destiny.
I wonder if it's just a voice actor thing. Some actors need a whole environment to be their character, and I wonder if they're like, okay, sit down and read this dialogue, and he just didn't get the character. Maybe that was a thing.
It depends on the actor. It depends on the actor.
Some are good at that, some are like, because I remember, like, this is kind of funny, going back to the old Star Trek animated, they were so stiff!
Yes.
In their sound. And so, it was like, yeah, I mean, even poor Leonard Nimoy, and that's because you're just sitting in a studio, you're not interacting, you don't have a crew or anything going on. You're not in your makeup. You're not in your character. You're just reading lines into a void, and it's like you got to project this character into nothingness. And maybe he doesn't handle that as well.
It takes a special talent to be able to do,
because this is an actor. He's great
acting in front of the camera.
I like
as
his characters
well
that
as
he's
voice acting.
Yeah, and I've liked his characters that he's played.
Yeah, I mean, so that's happening. Square Enix is in talks with the Swedish developer of Just Cause 3 to use their physics technology.
Swedish. There'll be meatballs in this.
Square Enix publishes their games, the Just Cause series.
Just Cause.
And the Just Cause 3 uses this physics engine where explosions are controlled by the physics engine. Where instead of, you know, how in most games an explosion will be just a pre-rendered, pre-made shower of particles and 2D flat
special effects.
Special effects. This one, it's basically almost random. I've seen some of the videos on the technology. It's really good.
There's applied physics
to the explosions and other things, and I don't think they're going to have the crazy grappling hook in Final Fantasy 14, I mean, or 15, but they're definitely wanting to use the physics engine, so they're in talks with them to collaborate, possibly on Final Fantasy 15 to bring that engine into the game, as well as any future games.
I know the two games that I always thought the explosions were always very fun was, what was that? It was one of the Mars games. What was that? Red Faction. There was one where you got to blow stuff up. That was sort of satisfying. Oh. And the other game that was relatively fun to play around with explosions was Minecraft.
Yes.
There were so many, especially when you, like, creeper!
Boom! Yes. There's a whole story behind that.
Yeah.
Here's a news item that is of interest to you. After Dark expansion for City Skylines.
I've been waiting for this.
Yeah, this was debuted at Gamescom. Gamescom is essentially E3 for Europe, but it's better than our E3. Because E3 is a trade show for insiders and the press, whereas Gamescom is open to the public.
I've been playing Civ games for a long time, and in fact, I've been playing it lately a lot, and there are mods that you can't quite simulate night. One of the mods kind of cheats a little bit by just kind of getting it to dusk and then just switching instantly to dawn. Very good one. Put that with Sunshaft's mod, and very nice looking. But most of the mods that have tried to simulate a nighttime, the game just becomes unplayable, playable during that part of the cycle, because there's just simply no city illumination. But from what they've said is that, and I've watched the, I watched their presentation, they're going to add, nighttime is not just going to be a special effect anymore like it was in the past. It's actually going to have an impact on the simulation. You're going to have traffic flow pattern differences, you're going to have crime fluctuations. Mm-hmm. They're adding specializations for the commercial zones like they do with, like, farmland and with farm and forestry. They're going to add that for commercial zones. You're going to have beachfront properties and... What was the other one?
It's actually going to affect the behavior of the Sims in that world.
Right, and what's going to happen is, it's during the nighttime cycle, certain elements of the simulation will be different. So your traffic flows will be different and everything. So it's going to have a practical effect. And there's some questions about how it's going to work and the timing and things like that. But, you know, just reasonable values will be fine probably. And there'll be mods and stuff that'll go with it and things, I'm sure. But it'll be interesting. It'll be a great addition. The game really needs it.
This is going to fundamentally change how the game plays.
I wouldn't say fundamentally, but it definitely will create more challenges at certain stages of development. You're going to have prisons! Prisons are finally going to be in the game, so you're going to have prisons now.
Yes.
So,
now
you can arrest your citizens now.
We can thank EA for this game becoming so popular.
I never touched that thing.
They pretty much killed off SimCity.
Well, honestly, you know, they may have done everyone a favor by getting it away from them, and now that we've got it separated out, you've got new development.
Mm-hmm.
And I think fresh minds and the corporatocracy has no longer gotten a hold of it. You know, I think the only thing danger for Parallax,
Colossal Order.
Colossal Order and them is to be careful about how they grow. And I think they're conscious of this. Is because, I mean, they know that they were like, what was it, 10, 15 people. Now they're like 200 or something.
Yeah.
So the success is causing them to grow. So they just need to be cautious about how they grow. And that being having a very successful game is going to draw attention where people are going to want to buy them out to take their properties and stuff like that. And they just need to be cautious of that. That they don't, you know, that they mind how they handle that going forward. That's just my thought to them, is just be cautious of that. Because, you know, we've seen what happened to Maxis, you know. Mm-hmm. Maxis RIP is, you know, the biggest casualty in the whole SimCity, Maxis, EA thing, the biggest casualty in all of that, and the saddest one of all to that, to me, is Spore. Because I remember seeing Will Wright videos before it was released, and what he had was utterly amazing. There were features in there that never made it into the game.
It was supposed to be his magnum opus.
It really was. It was going to be an utter work of art, and what we got was an utter meme.
Yeah. Awful.
It was terrible, and the fact that SimCity fell off the plate for this is not a surprise. I'll tell you what, if anything, Colossal Order, I wish they would do, is go back and look at what Will Wright tried to do with Spore and try to recreate that in the same way, spiritual successor to Spore, and get us back to where we, you know, really could be with a true multi-level simulation system like what Spore was supposed to be. Look at Will Wright's videos and see what he had and start from there.
Because of all this, he's not even involved in game development anymore.
He should go. I mean, he's got his own life to live, but my feeling is he should go and look at some of these smaller indie companies and go back into this type of. It'd be great to have him back, but I mean, I'm sure he's got his own path to follow, I'm sure.
Follow in the footsteps of a lot of Japanese developers in the auteur movement, where they are breaking ties to their big corporations and going off on their own. And with smaller companies and crowdsourcing.
Yeah, I think that's good. I think that that seems to be the trend for a lot of developers is like they can't. I mean, you're never going to see the end for a while of EA and the mega corp, you know, hash out games. But there will always be a place for everyone else because there's, you know, with the internet, PCs and stuff like that, there's plenty of room for independent developers. And there are so many ideas out there, so many new, and people kind of rehash what's been done. But there are a lot of inventive, creative things coming, too.
I'd like to do a whole show on this whole, on the whole thing with the current state of the AAA studios. Because that's an important thing, because right now they're in a situation right now to where they're setting themselves up for a crash.
That could be a whole show. I mean, there's enough topic on that. That's a long one.
Because they're stagnating. That's a long topic. They're stagnating, and I'd like to go deeper into that. So maybe we can do another show on that.
That might be a good idea.
Maybe episode 4 we will cover that. ZeniMax Online has finally shown a trailer for the next expansion to Elder Scrolls Online.
I thought that was out. Or is this a new one?
It's coming in August 31st for PC and Mac, September 15th for Xbox One, and the next day, September 16th, for PS4. And this is a DLC pack that adds the entire Imperial City.
Okay, so they added the Imperial City, but they didn't add all of it? Because I thought we already had the Imperial City. Yeah. I haven't played it in a while.
No, the Imperial City has not been accessible until now.
Okay, so this is the Imperial City. Okay, I thought this had already come out.
Yep. This is the entire Imperial City. They include new veteran. They include new veteran rank items and gear and exclusive pets, polymorphs, and costumes that you can acquire only there. All the content is accessible to characters level 10 and up. You can switch over to the PvP, PvE. It's sort of a hybrid PvP, PvE area with its own quests. This finishes out the storyline that began when your character was in Cold Armor. This finishes the story. And then all DLC after that will be new story that follows. a new campaign.
Okay, so they finished that main scenario, yeah. Sort of like the way 255 did for Realm Reborn.
Because what you're doing is you're trying to take the capital to put a new emperor in place, while at the same time you're fighting the Daedra. You're fighting off Molag Bal's forces.
When you say emperor, this is definitely not going to be what's his name?
Talos?
Talos.
No.
Talos shouldn't arrive for quite some time.
He's a few hundred years. He hasn't even been born yet. It's a few hundred years before he's
born. I don't see how they'll ever get to a point of ever having him, because you'd have to transition the story in some weird way. Yeah.
But all the Imperial City districts are there. They have new quests and NPCs. It will feature PvP and PvE areas. There will be new PvE dungeons. And it'll be a shared area beneath the Imperial City in the sewers, where each faction will have their own region, and there'll be a sort of a no man's land in the middle, where you can basically run into anybody or anything. So it's going to be interesting. They're wanting to release a new set of DLC every 12 weeks. They want to keep the content coming. Anyone who is currently subscribed, like I am, and I think you still have
I still have a subscription.
You will get this automatically.
Is it going to... Okay, now, so that begs my first question. Am I going to have to spend crown points on this, or are they just going to... Because I've already subscribed, it's going to be just an activated download.
Since you're already subscribed, it's an activated download.
Okay. I was going to say that
everyone else playing for free. Yeah, everyone else playing for free can buy it through the crown store.
So if you're playing for free, you have to buy it through the crown store.
Yeah.
But if you are already subscribed, if you're using a subscription model, you get it essentially with no extra cost. It's part of your subscription.
Yes.
Okay.
All right, this next item touches on what we sort of watched the end of yesterday, because we were having some trouble with Steam, and I found out that it was the International that was taking place, their annual Dota 2 championship.
Yeah, we watched
live stream. We caught the end of it anyway. Yeah, where the evil geniuses basically won the International. Well, very soon, esports gamers will have to take the same kind of drug tests that regular athletes take. This is because there have been some teams that have basically come out and said that they have used Adderall for improving their response times.
It's a sad thing when you're down to that and just for a video game. It's one thing when you got... You know, you have millions of dollars and stuff, and the way the sports system works and everything, but you're doing this for a video game. You really got to rethink what you're doing.
Esports is really growing. It's gaining. I mean, you can get visas in the United States now to come in and play in an esports team, a special esports visa for, like, League of Legends. I think they might even be doing it for Dota 2 now. Here in the U.S. Special visas to actually compete. I mean, it's growing as a sport. And there were even, we were watching this, and it was like watching a game, because they had...
You had a crowd in the background, you had the announcer going on, you had all that. Yeah, you had a guy come in and play music at the end, it was like...
And there is big money involved in this, too. And there's sponsorship, there's millions
of sponsorships. We actually saw this in the game. There was signs in the game with logos.
Oh, yeah. I saw...
What was it? AT&T or somebody else?
AT&T, I think T-Mobile.
Yeah, T-Mobile. That was the one you saw. I remember T-Mobile, you calling them out.
There were a few...
That they're actually in the game on the banners and things hanging around like you'd see in a sports arena.
I think I saw an NVIDIA logo in there somewhere.
Probably did.
Or it's a game, so NVIDIA would be in there somewhere. AMD.
That's amazing.
Oh, definitely.
That's crazy. But that's... There you have it.
Yeah. Intel is finally shipping their 14-nanometer quad-core Skylake processors. And this features DDR4 support, more PCI Express lanes, the voltage regulator has been moved off the chip onto the motherboard, so it's a new socket LGA 1151. Currently, the current line of processors is LGA 1150. This has a TDP of 94 watts, so it's not very high power. It has a new, they requires a new chipset of Z170 Express. And it, they don't come with stock coolers. These are overclockable chips.
You know, I never understood why they always came with them anyway, because all the ones I've ever gotten, I've never used them.
I figured most people would just put them in there, unless you're overclocking, you don't really need anything more.
I guess, but, I mean, I half the time whenever I've built a machine, I've always replaced the stock cooler. I don't think, have I ever used it? No, I've got a small stack of laying around somewhere.
Now, well, this chip is an incremental increase. It's not a massive jump in performance. It's a small jump in performance, but what it is it's lower power consumption and a smaller die. This is their 14 nanometer. This is built with their 14 nanometer process that's been having troubles.
From everything you did said it was, it just sounds like a basic redesign of the basic technology. The layout's different, which to me says new motherboard and a few other things like that you're going to have to go along with it, because you said they moved the voltage regulator to the motherboard. I'm like, okay, you need a new motherboard for that.
Yeah, it's their new Skylake codenamed architecture chip.
The interesting thing would be to see where they can go from it from here. Yeah. It's one thing to redesign everything, but does this give you future expandability, future capability?
The good thing is you get 40 PCI Express lanes instead of 20, which is really good for new storage like M.2 and SATA Express and PCI Express storage options, which are much faster, that bypass the SATA controller altogether, and are incredibly fast. Mm-hmm. Now, so this benefits that. It has a new Iris Pro GPU. Still not the best for gaming, but it's an improvement. You can do 4K video with this pretty easily. Here's a biggie. And apparently this is happening with a lot of companies. Verizon is dropping contracts and phone subsidies completely across the board. Now, existing contracts will stay in place, but they're not going to be doing contracts anymore. They're not doing phone subsidies. You'll buy them from them.
Also phone subsidies, because that's why the contracts were there, because they were essentially having you pay. You were paying for the the phones without them subsidizing them are more likely to be in the neighborhood of $500-$600. Mm-hmm. And they can get people to buy them because nobody wants to buy a $600 phone. Mm-hmm. That's how they've been able to get people to adopt all the smartphones and stuff.
Yeah, you can either buy the phone in full or you can pay for it in small increments with whatever plan you've chosen.
Now, what happens? Well, I'm assuming that if you leave with like it was when you break your contract, well, we want you to pay for everything up front. I get that. I mean,
there's no contract with this. No.
No, what I'm saying is if you're having them pay for the phone, you're paying it for it in increments. If you leave early, it's either give them, it's probably somewhere along the lines of give them back.
Oh, I'm
the
sure
phone
there
or,
would be a, I'm sure
a,
there would be
or,
some
or a
kind
separation
of,
fee of some kind.
Yeah, I'm sure there will be a fee.
They'll have
there
to do that. Otherwise, people will sign up, grab the phone, and just. That's a good thing. I think what they've discovered is people are really starting to hate the whole contract idea.
Yeah.
That's never been a very popular thing at all.
Mm-hmm.
I think people feeling like they're bound to them in some kind of way has never been. Contracts great for companies, bad for people. And unless it's something that you're trying to do specifically, where you're needing, generally as a consumer, if you're going to be a contract, it's because you're asking somebody to do something for you. This is where the company's asking you to do something for them.
Yeah.
And that's where it's kind of not right.
Yeah.
And so this is. Now, if Verizon does it, the rest will follow suit.
Yeah.
The only other thing they need to do is drop this whole data plan, give it a goop.
That's still a part of this, but that's the next step, hopefully.
Yeah, because the whole data plan thing, that's a farce. They weren't doing it before the whole internet stuff really kind of took off. And then it's like, okay, we're going to meet your internet. It's like, it's going to be. Eventually, they're going to turn this around. You're going to start seeing advertisements for, oh, we offer, cheap data rates, even cheaper data rates. Now we offer free data rates. It's like, you offered free data rates to begin with, and you went into it, and then you advertise it as a feature as you're getting rid of it.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever.
Well, their new service plans offer unlimited voice and messaging.
Yeah, it makes no sense. You turn around and, because there's no difference because it's all digital now anyway. Yeah. By the time it's all, I mean, all your analog voice signals are all digitized anyway, and so is text.
Mm-hmm.
What's the difference? The only thing that's different about it at all is that somebody might use their phone to hook to their computer and play videos, but you do that on the phone anyway.
Yeah.
And I mean, I know that. God. I didn't even realize I had done this one time, is I have a Vudu subscription.
Mm-hmm.
And I was watching a video and forgot that I had the data plan on. It slurped that data plan within minutes. I was trying to watch video. I'm like, ding, ding. I'm like, what's wrong with my phone? I go back and look. Oh, you're out of data. I'm like, I didn't, what, but. So that's kind of where, and that's less of a problem for us and more they need to just solve their infrastructure issues.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the plans are, they wanted to simplify the plans because they felt that they were just too complicated for consumers. And they were. I mean,
it was a mess.
So they simplified it to 1 gig for 30, 3 gigs for 45, 6 gigs for 60, 12 gigs for 80. Now those are the ones they're advertising. Apparently there are larger plans that they don't directly advertise that you can get through the store. Mm-hmm. If you go to a Verizon store. Now for, on top of that, for phones, it's $20 to act to connection for smartphones, $10 for each tablet or Wi-Fi hotspot, $5 for any cellular enabled smart watch.
Anyway, honestly, the other thing that needs to be done, along with this contract thing going away, a couple mm-hmm. of things, along we talked about data,
yeah,
is provisioning the phone, tying it to a particular company.
Yeah.
That needs to go away. Because if you're going to make us, if we have the option of paying for a $600 phone, and we want to move carriers, we should mm-hmm. have the right to just pull that chip out, go to the phone store, have them give us another chip for their company, stick it in there, and then now we're on their network.
You can buy, this opens the door to being able to buy an unlocked phone.
It ought to be that way. I mean, it really, really, really ought to be that way anyway. The whole locked phone thing is kind of stupid.
Yeah.
And that way, let the manufacturers make us the best phones they can make without having it tied to anybody and preloading all the junk that we never use anyway onto them, mm-hmm. which is hard burned into the BIOSes of these phones.
Fortunately, a lot of the new interesting phones don't work on their network. The OnePlus One doesn't work on Verizon.
It works on Sprint, but it doesn't work on Verizon. Have an industry standard that says here's the protocol you need to be able to communicate with their system, and make sure your receivers can pick up their signals.
Yeah.
And you know, take the major carriers and their frequencies and their signals and be able to have the receiver be able to you know, transmit and receive on them. And if you'd like your carrier, see what it does is it puts the onus back on the carriers to do a good job, quote unquote.
Yeah.
Not just feed you whatever bull hockey that they can feed you. And so if they suck as a service, you know, then they just suck as a service and nobody's gonna carry them. But, you know, there will be people who want them for other reasons, and it's what they offer us, it puts the competition back into it where it ought to be. Everyone goes on about competition in business. Well, that's what this ought to be. This is what ought to be supported.
Right now, it looks as if there's
It's borderline monopoly right now.
It's borderline monopoly, and it looks like there's a lot of collusion between the companies, too, in order to prevent competition.
Don't get me started on the deep side of that. But anyway.
Yeah. Well, there's more battery fire woes. This time it hits NVIDIA. They've been recalling Shield tablets.
Battery fire woes. So where the battery of the tablet goes kaput.
Yeah.
Catches flame.
There's been a lot of problems with batteries catching fire in different devices. And the latest to get hit is NVIDIA with their Shield tablet.
Is this just from bad batteries, or the system yanking too much power out of it at one time and overloading it?
They went with a different supplier for these batteries than they did with the original batch.
Then you want to talk about canceling contracts. I think there's a contract out there that needs to go...
Yeah. So if anyone has the Y01 batteries, then they are part of the recall.
Okay, so the now will you just send them your device, or are they going to just send, are they going to send you a new battery, or how's that going
to
work?
They'll have details on their website on what you need to do. Very likely, similar to what we had to do with our Onkyo device, where we had to send it in.
Because that's what I had to do with my MacBook, because I had, my MacBook wasn't a battery, it was a bad fan.
Yeah.
That they put in them, and I mailed it off, and they mailed it back with a repaired fan.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Okay, Japan's National Institute of Informatics. Has created a item called the Privacy Visor. It looks like a regular pair of wraparound sunglasses, or those kind of wraparound glasses that people would wear during sports.
Does this give me X-ray vision?
No, what this does, what this does is it can 90% of the time, thwart facial recognition technology.
Ha!
And they will go on sale next year for $249.
Well, there are some places, like, I don't know about Japan, but I know in Europe, this might be true for Japan, that there are cameras everywhere!
Especially in England.
Yeah, they got it bad. I mean, they got more cameras than they knew what to do with. Mm-hmm. And you know that they're using facial recognition across that software and whatnot. So this is supposed to thwart that. Of course, you know it'll become a technology cold war where it's like, okay, well, this pair of goggles, thwarts it, and then they're like, mm-hmm. Okay, so we're going to make this software that's going to thwart the thwarting, and then, well, there you go. It's going to just start a little technology war.
Yeah, and it just has a special pattern on it that
scrambles their software.
That confuses facial recognition software. Before, they had these weird designs that looked like goggles with these near-infrared LEDs on them for it. But these, they just look like ordinary wraparound glasses that anybody would wear. Wraparound sunglasses anyone would wear.
They should have it so that it sets it off and makes it think it's like a politician or something. That'd be fun. I don't know. They do it and they get a George Bush or a Barack Obama walking around all over across the entire country. That'd be fun.
And here's an interesting one, just for fun. Chris Hadfield from Canada is considered, like, the nicest astronaut in the world. He's considered just the nicest guy.
Okay, now with that introduction, it makes me want to ask, what'd he do?
Well,
with that introduction, I want to know, what did he do?
He recorded an entire album on the International Space Station, and it'll be going on sale on October 9th.
Ha! Huh. So he recorded it while he was up there?
Yeah, he recorded it while he was up there. In fact, he's the first person to play David Bowie's Space Oddity while actually in space.
There's a certain irony to that.
Yes. So, people just love him. I mean, he's a, as I would say it again, he's a nice guy. He's even retired so that other Canadian astronauts can actually get a chance to go up to the International Space Station. I mean, he's considered a national treasure by Canada. I mean, he's just a nice guy.
Okay.
Well, let's talk about the aftermath of the Windows 10 launch. Yeah. Well, not so much the aftermath. It's been roughly 2 weeks since Windows 10 launched.
Okay.
And I installed it about a day or two after the launch. You've installed it much sooner.
I've had it a few days. It's been for a few days for me.
Yeah. And I like it. I use it on my gaming rig. I don't use it as my daily driver. My daily driver is a System76 laptop with Ubuntu. We're recording this on Ubuntu right now on Linux using Audacity. But I game with Windows 10 now, and I like it. The installation process was pretty simple.
Mostly. I can contest that a little bit.
Well,
I got a story there.
Mine was smoother. You can tell your story here, but my installation was pretty smooth. I had Windows 7 Pro installed, And it was a fresh installed Windows 7 Pro because I had gotten that because I had a copy before. And I wanted to try Windows 10 when it came out. Also, I had some trouble running GTA 5 because it wanted Service Pack 1. I couldn't get Service Pack 1 to install. So I went and got a new copy of Windows 7 Pro and installed on my machine. It was Service Pack 1, and I was able to play the game.
After you did the update, or before, are you talking about?
After it was
to get Pro running.
The disc was Windows 7 Pro Service Pack 1.
Ah.
Okay. With it already included.
Okay.
So I already had that installed, and then one day I noticed I had this little window icon on my system tray. And come to find out, it was the thing, it was the tool for reserving your copy of Windows 10. And so you had to have your Windows 7 installation fully up to date in order to get that. And so I reserved my copy, and then the day it came out, there were some updates to Windows 7 installed through Windows Update, and then after that, Windows Update had the message saying the Windows 10 installation was ready to install. And so it installed via Windows Update. So it ran some things while it was running, and then it restarted, and it did some things. It took about 15, 20 minutes to install, restarted, came up to the start screen. It still starts very much like Windows 8. Where you have your login screen that's covered up with a panel that has the clock. You just click on it, it slides up, and then you type in your password or your PIN, however you would set it up, and log on. And so far it's been good. I have not had any issues. All my hardware worked. It worked with my sound card. My configuration was still set up to where I was getting audio via HDMI. I have audio coming through HDMI from the my graphics card to my HDTV, and I have my speakers connected. I have my speakers and headphones connected to the external port on the TV. I have a little switch box that I can switch back and forth between headphones and speakers. My headphones are on an amp, so I can get good audio. And the my laptop's set up the same way. That way I don't have to do any complicated things to switch the audio around. I used to have to go to the audio amp in Ubuntu a lot to switch between headphone and speakers. Now I don't have to do that. Now it's just a simple switch under my desk.
That sounds like the kind of rigging I would do after a while to something.
Yeah, but I had no installation issues. Now I had a little hiccup with one of my games, but I was able to resolve that. I was with Unreal Tournament 2004. Now you had installation issues.
I had installation issues. Well, part of it was this system was is about. 4 years old, I think, now.
Mm-hmm.
So I've had it for a while. Now, at some time back, I had one patch or something that didn't install it properly or whatever a long time ago, and so I'd turned Windows Update off. So my machine's been running without Windows Update for quite some time. It's like, I should have had it updated, but like, man, if things were working, why break it? And I had a Vast on there and a few other things, so I was like, okay, I'm fine. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to go ahead and try Windows 10. I'll go ahead and give it a try. So I said, I have everything updated. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to go ahead and do the update. So go to turn this on, turn that on, turn off this, turn off that, get things kind of set up so that I can do it. Because I had a few things kind of starting that I didn't want to getting in the way. And so I run all the Microsoft updates of the updates of the updates. I can finally catch up, and it says, you have no more updates. Okay, I'm caught up. And I'm like, okay, where's the icon? Okay. So I'm like, okay, so what's the deal with this icon? Apparently, there's this issue that my machine had it, and apparently some people have had this happen to them, where this The number, I remember most of the number, actually, because I was fought with this so hard. It's like KB3035,
3035558, I think it is. I hate Microsoft's naming schemes for their updates.
I know, it's like KB30358, or 303558, I believe it was. Mm-hmm. And that was the little icon. That was your little icon in the corner. And I managed to get everything else out of the way and got down to where that would install, but would not show up. Actually, sometimes it would act like it's installed and not do anything. Other times it would not install and say it would. I mean, so I ran the tool that Microsoft provided in order to get it to, you know, fix, you know, do all the system checks and everything, make sure your machine's ready. And it said everything's fine, except for that. It hasn't ran. And so I kind of smacked my head on it, trying to get it to run. Uninstalled, reinstalled, over and over and over. Finally, I was like, okay, this ain't working. There's nothing else on this machine that this tool is complaining about. There was some software that it had said were incompatible, and I was like, these things I'm not even using anymore. I pulled all that off. Finally, I'm like, all right, that does it. After doing some little more research, I discovered there's a site where you can go and you can get an installer. It's a little download. It's kind of one of those little mini download installers that, you know, does all the downloading and stuff. And basically that was the method I used, was that download installer basically went out, grabbed the Windows 10 installation files, and basically started the install from there. And after doing that, it was, once that got started, everything was smooth. Everything was, now once I got into Windows 10, there were some initial bizarre issues because there was some incompatibility with some software that it did not catch. I think I had VLC, not VLC, but VNC, I think it was. It was a desktop server, and there was a virtual machine software that were having it, that was kind of having issues and things like that. There was a small army of little bitty odds and ends that were not compatible, and then there were some things that were starting up that were not compatible.
I think it was BNC and Daemon Tools.
Daemon Tools it caught. It caught Daemon Tools and said, this isn't compatible with Windows 10. I'm not surprised. And I just had the free version of them anyway, so I'm like, screw it, I'll just go get the other ones later. You know, if I need it. I'm not even sure what I was using it for. I think I might have been using it to have a way to have my Linux box shut my Windows machine down. I think that's what I used it for. I'm not even sure of that. I don't know. I hadn't used it in so long. I'm like, forget it. I'll just go get it. If I need it again, I know where to find it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I did all the other necessary updates. I mean, once I got Windows 10 installed and found the rest of the weeds, as I was calling them, and cleaned out a few other things, I went through, you know, my list of software that I had on my machine and cleaned out some old stuff. And once I did this, once I kind of cleaned it up and kind of took some old stuff off that really wasn't necessary, compatible or whatever, it started working well. There was a point where it just like, okay, I'm going to work now. It just started working, and, you know, I got whatever was in out of the way. And after that, it just started working just fine once I cleaned it up. And now, you know, I've been playing around. I didn't even use Windows 8. So I wasn't even familiar with, like, the paneling and all the other stuff that they got on. And so I was kind of looking around, getting used to, you know, going from Windows 7 to Windows 10 is quite a jump. So getting used to, and one thing I did like, this was nice. This is probably one of my favorite features so far, is I have two monitors. I have a dual monitor set up. The second monitor now has its own desktop icon arrangement and its own start menu. I liked that feature. I was like, this is not a separate desktop. This is an extension of my desktop, but it also includes its own start menu and icon locations. I liked that. Some of the other things, the notifications bar is kind of nice for, like, emails and things. Just kind of look, you know, kind of poke my nose over there and see if there's anything kind of popping up. A few other little apps here and there I've kind of tried out. I like. I also noticed, well, this is a separate topic we can do another time, but I noticed they're offering Office a different way. They're offering it subscription now. As I looked at the Get Office 10 thingy or something like that.
That's something they've been doing for some time now.
I mean, I didn't even notice it until then. So I'm like, I'll try it, because, I mean, I liked Office when I used to work. So overall, the overall system performance, it starts a little slower, it seems like.
than it used to. I'm not sure. There's this long delay during startup. I'm not sure what's causing that.
I don't know. Well, your machine has got a special configuration.
Yeah, so maybe it's because it's starting something with the SLI or something. Maybe there's some graphics thing it's having to initialize. It takes a little while.
Mine boots pretty quickly.
Yeah, I saw yours booting really fast, and I was like, why isn't mine booting that fast? Mm. But once it gets going now, once it actually gets up and running, it's actually been quite nice. I've actually, most of what I've looked at, I've liked so far. And I did go ahead, I only had Windows Home Premium for Windows 7. I don't know, I thought I had, so it only upgraded me to Windows Home, Windows 10 Home. And it was like a $99 upgrade to go from Home to Pro. So I was like, okay, I'll go ahead and do it. So I got Pro now on my machine. Not sure I really needed it though, but I wanted control over the update process. So all in all, and I like the menu, like when you right click the menu now, the start menu, it gives you more options. Yeah. So overall, I mean, compared to how Microsoft's done things in the past, this was pretty different. I mean, despite my bump in the road issues, I was, you know, like, especially with the cost of the, I'm only paying $99 for going from Pro to Home to Pro, but the actual upgrade itself, I could have just stopped right there and it'd been free. That was pretty incredible. I was just like, wow, okay. Yeah. And then Office being on subscription, that's real cheap. I'm like, alrighty then, things are different over at Microsoft.
Yeah, my installation experience with Windows 10 has been very uneventful.
I love drama, I guess. I
mean, it was pretty easy. Installation was pretty easy. I have not run into any other compatibility issues with software on this machine. I didn't have Avast on previously. You know, they had reinstalled Windows 7.
I took mine off and it took over with its own, I think Windows Defender's got an antivirus module built into it. Because the first thing it did was catch a couple of viruses off in some files that were laying around somewhere.
Yeah, it's supposed to be just a malware detector, but it may have antivirus as well. But I haven't run into many compatibility issues yet. I had one with Unreal Tournament 2004. Mm-hmm. Now, it turns out that I had to go into the INI file for the game under the game directory system, go to UT2004.ini, and I had to edit a line or change mouse smoothing from true to false, and then the game would launch, and I could play it just fine after that.
Yeah, of all the games I've tried so far, I have not had any issues.
I had some weird artifacts, and you were watching. I was playing GTA 5.
You were playing GTA 5, I had some weird visual artifacts.
And had some weird visual artifacts.
I'm beginning to think that might be an artifact with bugs in DirectX 11. Because I saw those same issues in Final Fantasy 11, or sorry, 14, at one point, and they had to patch some stuff in the game. So the game may just need a patch where they may not have caught everything yet. There may be some minor bugs. It seems to be with textures and polygons and not things not lining up right.
Yeah.
I know there's probably a name for that effect, but I'm not sure what it's called.
I know I've seen it in a lot of games where you just have these weird geometric lines just
flying everywhere
on the screen.
Yeah, it's like a point that's shared across multiple polygons has suddenly decided to be elsewhere. So all the polygons are now stretched to that mysterious other point.
Yeah, I've seen it before in a lot of games.
It's happened before,
but it wasn't severe. It didn't happen a lot, but it happened in usually when I was out of the city, in the northern areas where it was more sparse, more mountainous. Usually, it happened there above.
The texture decides to be someplace else.
Yeah, and yeah. I've been playing Dishonored. I play through all of Tomb Raider. I maxed out all the settings in Tomb Raider, and I turned on Tress Effects, and the game just ran buttery smooth. The Tress Effects is the AMD special feature where Laura's hair will look realistic, move realistically. Each strand is calculated in physics.
Hmm.
So it looked really good. and I've been playing Dishonored. Dishonored runs really well. And today I'm playing I'm playing Far Cry 3.
I was gonna say, if you got Fallout 4, I want a piece of that.
No, I don't have Fallout 4 yet. That's not yet. I'm playing Far Cry 3, and I max the settings, and I'm getting smooth frame rates. Mm-hmm. And the gaming performance under Windows 10 is like, people, I've been reading different posts and seeing different news, mm-hmm. and everybody is saying that they're getting, everyone's saying that they're getting better gaming performance with Windows 10.
Yeah.
I've definitely seen
I think Microsoft's finally, what I'm getting from this, to me, my point of view on mm-hmm. this might be, it seems like Microsoft's finally understood that Windows is not just a business operating system, that one of the other reasons why people still hang on to Windows, which has kind of helped kind of keep them around and keep them relevant, one of the reasons that Windows has stayed around these all these years is because of gaming. It was the one thing you still, no matter how far you wanted to throw Windows into the trash can, it was the one thing you had to keep it for. It was the one thing for a home user, if there was any reason why you wanted to keep Windows, it was strictly gaming. People would dual boot, you know, multi-machine, whatever their purposes were, mm-hmm. they usually had to keep it around for that. And maybe Microsoft finally understood who its part of its real audience really was, and to finally tune Windows so that it would really be, you know, usable by that crowd. They want to keep it for other things, not just, you know, gaming.
And there's a lot of console fanboys out there who think PC gaming is a really small niche.
No, PC's not a small niche. There's no niche there. No, there's some games that you can only play on a PC. Mm-hmm.
A lot of games you can only play on PC.
Yeah, I mean, the console market is not the end all of the universe. In fact, I would almost dare to say the console market is actually more threatened by PC than PC is by console market by far. I'm not saying it's going away. I'm saying that it's easier to have a game be on the PC and be playable, because you can adapt. You can see if the game's designed for controller options, you got a controller. You can put a keyboard and mouse. It's a little more difficult when you have it sitting in front of your TV. Mm-hmm. The thing about consoles are, they do one thing that the video game, the PC's not quite as good at. And that's, you're able to sit in your living room in your nice big giant comfy chair and see it on your big giant honking television screen in full digital surround sound, fill in the whole room, sit back, relax, and blow somebody away. That's a little harder to do on your PC. Your PC doesn't really sit well with that environment. I mean, unless you've got a gaming rig sitting in there, but then again, you're not using it for probably, you know, typing emails. Yeah. That was likely, anyway.
That's why Valve's...
That keeps consoles relevant.
Yeah, that's why Valve's doing the whole thing with the Steam machines, mm-hmm. and also with the Steam Link, which is a little micro console that you set up in your living room, and you stream your games over your network to your TV. And you play them with a controller or mouse and keyboard.
Well, see, that makes sense, because then you can kind of get a little bit of the best worlds. And they've caught on to that. That's how people are using their computers. That's how people are using their consoles. And mm-hmm. to try, in that case, it looks like what they're doing is trying to bring a little bit of that console feel to a machine that you couldn't otherwise easily stick in your living room.
Yeah, because there's an Xbox app in Windows 10. So you can get, you know, look at your Xbox Live. Because you can... When you set up an account, Microsoft account, you're also on Xbox Live. And you get achievements. You can get achievements and stuff through games that you buy through their store.
I've seen the app. I've not ran it. I saw the Xbox app in the panel screen, but I have not yet ran that.
Now, it's supposed to do streaming from the Xbox One to Windows 10. So you can actually sit at your computer and play Xbox One games while someone is watching TV.
To me, that's kind of odd. I would just give me a PC version of the game. I mean, let's just simplify that and give me a PC version, thank you.
Yes. Now, there's been talk that they may actually go the other way.
To me, that would make way more sense.
Where you can play a PC game and stream it to your Xbox One.
Honestly, I'll tell you what. Considering what Steam is doing, if it takes off on Steam, Microsoft's going to copy them. Microsoft will fire up the Xerox machine. And copy them.
Yeah. Now, of course, it may only work with games that you can buy through their store. We may not be able to stream Steam games this way, but, you know, Steam Link would be some what you would use for that.
Possibly. You know? That's usually the way these things wind up going, despite how much we don't want to.
Because I played around with Project Spark, and that's pretty interesting. I mean, you can build your own game with that pretty well.
I forgot completely about that. I was going to check that out, and I completely forgotten.
It's free on the Microsoft Store.
That's in the Microsoft Store.
Yeah, just go into the store and look for Project Spark.
Project Spark.
Yeah.
Remind me. I want to look at that. I remember seeing that.
I also grabbed the Minecraft beta for Windows 10. It's not a Java app anymore. You can still run the Java version, but there's a beta that runs using Microsoft's tools for creating new modern UI apps.
Mm.
It's pretty basic right now. There's some features that are missing, and it's a beta, but it's starting to look...
I've still been very, very jury still out on the whole Microsoft buying Minecraft.
I know.
There's probably a lot of people that feel like not sort of sold us out.
Yeah. At least they're letting them still do their own thing. I've been keeping an eye on that, and they're still letting them do their own thing. There's going to be Minecraft Story Mode, which is a game from Telltale, which is sort of it's in the same vein as, you know, their other games that they've been doing for Game of Thrones and The Walking Dead, which is sort of their point-and-click adventure games.
Right.
You know, with full voice acting and everything, the whole story to it. And what do you think of the new start menu? I think that it's what Windows 8 should have had.
The way that it does it, well, considering the way the panels are and everything, I think it makes a lot more sense. There's a few options I think it could have. Like, for example, some of these panels have displays of information.
Mm-hmm.
If I click on the start menu on that secondary screen, I told you it adds a menu, start menu to the secondary screen.
Mm-hmm.
But if I click away on another app that's on the first screen, what I really wouldn't mind, because if I'm not doing anything on that second screen,
mm-hmm.
is for it to just leave that open. So that way I can see those panels and see, like, emails and things. Kind of a stat screen. But I could immediately click on something and it'll go away if I'm doing something, if I want it to. And what I guess to have those available as kind of an information display. I mean, there's probably other ways of doing that, but that would be kind of an option. Start menu stays open until you close it. Kind of sounds weird, but the way I was looking at using it, I'm sitting there on one screen playing Cities, Skylines, or watching a video or something, and having that other screen just keep those panels open where they've got live information feeding to them. You can see emails, tweets, Facebook, and just kind of watch it. And then if I need something, I can go over and grab something from it, or just close it if I need to use that window.
If I recall, you can set it up to where you can either use it as a start menu, or use it as a regular start menu, or the start screen, or the old classic 8.1 start
screen. I didn't see a way to do that. It mostly behaves like the start menu. Now, you can expand it.
Yeah.
Like, the way that you were using it is the default, the way they did it. Now, you can just, those panels are there, and you can see them occasionally. The other option, you can have it expand where it'll cover the whole screen. I don't think it'll be like, this is what I'm talking about, is it where it will cover
it
the whole screen?
It has a transparency behind it. It doesn't cover the whole screen.
It doesn't
like
black
the
it out.
One. Yeah.
There's a layer of transparency to it, yeah. And then you can arrange the panels in there. You can create groups and stuff like that. So you can have it do a little more. The All Programs group and all that, and all the other options are still available. They kind of move off to the side a little bit to give more panel room. But if I'm doing that, and I kind of like, okay, I've got my Facebook up here. It's showing me, you know, posts. And I got my, I haven't tried Twitter yet, but I'm guessing it'll do the same thing. And I got my email over here, and it's doing that. Now I click on my City Skylines. It closes. And I'm like, well, that's less useful, because I wasn't doing anything on that screen. It could have stayed open.
I noticed that on your other, on your second screen, you also don't have the clock, and you don't have the system tray.
The system tray doesn't appear down there. So, like, if my notification area
is under what game I'm playing. So if I have to kind of click, I have to bring the start menu, click out of the window, and then that corner comes up, and then I can click on it. And that's the thing is, adding the clock and notifications to the other window, you know, where you bring it up by clicking on that little icon that's down there by the clock, and then adding an option where the start menu can stay open unless you specifically close it, or open an app or some other, you know, where you interact with it that causes it to open an app, close it. But if, unless you specifically close it, it'll stay open, where if you click on an app, when it's used in that way, on that screen, it might stay open. It's kind of a funky little thing, but it would be kind of a little nicety, because the way I'm using it.
Here's something that would be a nice feature to suggest, or you can already do it, we just haven't seen the options for it, is have that second screen as a separate desktop.
Yeah, but I drag stuff back and forth too much.
Yeah.
Unless it kind of behaves like that anyway. I don't know if it's trying to treat it that way. I don't know if it's treating it... it definitely behaves like one. Because it's got its own set of icons. It's got its own start menu. It's got its own, you know, the bar at the bottom with all the icons. It replicates my main bar completely.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's almost... if I full screen it, it only full screens to that screen. It's kind of behaving like that. It's almost like having two PCs side by side where you can just magically drag something between them.
Yeah.
It's kind of behaving that way now anyway. But I don't know how... I haven't tried its multi-desktop feature since, well, I sort of have two desktops and I've been kind of using it that way.
Now, those modern apps can take over the entire screen. There's a button you can press at the top.
Well, it's just full screen.
It's a full screen with the title bar hidden.
That's kind of all it does. For example, I use the Facebook app.
Mm-hmm.
Took me a minute to figure out how to navigate. Sometimes some of these apps don't feel very feature rich.
That's been the complaint about these apps for a long time with Windows 8. This is an ongoing issue that there are apps that are missing. There's apps that are missing from the library that Android and iOS have, and then the apps that Windows 8 does have, or Windows 8 and 8.1 had,
mm-hmm.
and that Windows 10 now uses.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of them feel like toys in comparison to what you have on Android or iOS.
Let me give an example. And this is one thing that I thought was kind of annoying. One thing I discovered was that Facebook and my mail show up on the notifications bar that comes along the side of the screen. And I thought, okay, well, you said, well, the news thing does it too. And I'm like, ah, okay.
Yeah, news app. I've been running into a problem with the news app where I select what news I want, and it doesn't keep the setting.
Well, this is what I was getting to, is... okay, I was looking at the news app, and I'm like, okay, this has got a bunch of crap that I don't care for.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, I only want certain categories. So what I was wanting was that only certain categories, tech, gaming, movie reviews, things like that. I wanted those kinds of topics to show up in that notification mm-hmm. bar, right?
Yeah.
So I finally got it to get those topics. So finally something showed up over there today. 10 children... and parents dead or something, and I'm like, this is not what I selected.
No, that's not what I selected.
This is not what I wanted. This is not what I was looking for.
Mm-hmm.
And to the point where I'm like, this app is not working at all. I'm ready to just cease using it because the idea is great. Mm-hmm. It's like, if Microsoft's listening, the idea is great, but you need to fix this app.
Yeah.
Because I wanted news about tech, and I wanted... movie reviews and a few other things. I wanted that to show up in that notification area. So, you know, honestly, what I'd rather have is, like I said before, the other window with all the different apps running, it stays open. These little things just have the information that's related to them, where I can resize them. And it's like, you know, my Twitter feed's coming up on one side, my Facebook feed's coming up on one side, you know, my news app's got some stuff, and that just stays over there until I do something with it. If I click on one of those, I get that app and get that link and get that information. Otherwise, I'm sitting there playing my game, and that sits off to the side and just feeds the stream of information coming by. It's none of it's working that way.
Or here's the thing. A new app introduced a new feature that lets you turn an app into a widget on your desktop.
What they could do is, when you open the start menu, you have these active tile boxes.
Yeah.
But let's say I don't have the start menu full screen. Let's say it's classic style, where it's smaller, it doesn't take up the whole screen, but you've got the tile sitting on one side. Drag the tile off onto the desktop, and it does nothing different than sit there and then meld into the background until you specifically click on it. And it'll highlight it if your mouse is over it, that if you click, you're going to get it. Other than that, it sits there and it runs in that state.
Basically put the live tiles on the desktop.
You just drop the live tile on the desktop. That would make even more sense.
Yeah.
Now, maybe some people don't like that. I mean, Macs have had that for a long time, where you can drag elements out of there. You know, you can help, you could even on Mac, you even had the feature of dragging page clippets out of web pages and mm-hmm. melding them into your desktop, and it would work. So let's say, you know, there's a title area where they would always put the same post, and it would be the current topic or something. You could literally cut that out and just drop it on your desktop. I mean, this doesn't even have that simplistic of a functionality.
Oh, when I used the Mac, I used to have a lot of them. In fact, one of the things I did was I put the turkey calculator for Thanksgiving on
there. I had a Vanity clock on mine. There was a web page that had a Vanity clock.
Yeah, I had the same thing.
And I cut that out and put it on the desktop in the background. Mm. Didn't always run it, but if I was playing the game a lot, I would have it up.
But I only used it during Thanksgiving whenever we had a turkey, but I would put from the Butterball website, I would put the turkey calculator there. Mm-hmm. That way I could just go there without having to go hunt for it again. It would be right there, and I'd put in what size turkey we had and how long it had to be cooked for.
Yeah, so Windows is missing a lot of that type of functionality. Maybe, I mean, considering they're going to be making Windows modular, maybe this will be a component that comes in the future, maybe. Hint, hint, Microsoft. Hint, hint.
Or they're going to be supporting this until, like, 2025, and Windows 7 until 2020.
Windows 10 until 2025?
Yeah, Windows 10 until 2025, 2025, 2030, somewhere around there. So it's going to be... It's basically going to have about a 10-year run.
But I thought the intent was that they're going to be adding components over time.
Yes.
That you would be able to go to the store and grab pieces of Windows and be able to have them install and run and have it do things where you really wouldn't get a full release. You would have, of course, service packs and things, but you would get components that you could download separately that you wouldn't get the whole thing.
Yeah, that's essentially what they're doing. I don't know what they mean by that, where
if it's just an app or if it's an actual feature like what we're talking about.
Yeah. Don't know. But,
that's what I've heard. I mean, I heard that a long time ago, but I don't know if that's the way they went.
Now, there have been some people that have been complaining about problems with SLI not working right, the Windows update, basically updating their drivers for their NVIDIA cards, whereas they were having the NVIDIA software, NVIDIA experience mm-hmm. doing it for them. There have been people having just trouble. I figured out what it is. Now, the Windows 10 Home Edition, what it does is it automatically installs important updates.
This is why I went to Pro.
Yeah. You don't have the option of turning off updates on Windows 10 Home.
This is why I went to Pro.
Yeah. Well, one of the reasons why is because one thing that's been really biting Microsoft in the ass for a long time is security problems.
Yes.
Security woes.
Yeah, people like me who turn it off.
They're notorious. They've had a notoriously bad rap for security problems on Windows.
Big time.
And they wanted to nip it in the bud and make it to where the home users automatically get all the security updates. They can't turn off a Windows update.
Yeah.
Now, we have the Pro version, where we can control when we install updates and which updates get installed.
Actually, from what I understand, it still downloads them. It still gets it to the point where it's ready to install them. It just says, now or later.
Yeah. You can even schedule when the computer restarts, if it has to restart.
Yeah, that whole Windows 7, we're just going to reboot on you in the middle of whatever you're doing was...
You're in the middle of a project you haven't saved yet, and then boom, it restarts.
Yeah.
And you just lost half an hour of work.
Me and Windows locked horns over that.
Yeah.
Somebody wants some TLC.
The kitty cats. And, yeah, people have been running into that trouble. I think it's mostly, I think the people who are running into this problem with this, I believe it's Windows 10 Home that they're using.
You think it's updating that driver? Because I do know that I'll say this. Before I did the update, because I have the same software you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Before I did the update, I did not update my video driver, and I do remember getting a message saying that there was new stuff for it.
Mm-hmm.
But after the update, I did check it, and it said it's up to date. So that video driver got updated during that installation process.
Yeah.
I'm not surprised at that, but that means it did it without that software doing it. And I think that might be where it's kind of gotten tangled.
Yeah. And you didn't run into this particular problem, but some people have been having trouble with multiple monitors, getting Windows 10 to recognize their second monitor.
Well, I already had it. Now, here's the possibility. I had it running when I did the installation. In fact, here's what was interesting. Briefly, during the installation, the Windows setup actually only appeared on the second monitor first. I was like, uh-oh, here we go, getting it recognized which monitor's which, and then it jumped back.
Ah.
It was like Windows went, oh, whoops, I'm back over here again. It was weird because for 30 seconds, it was on the wrong screen.
Yeah.
And then it jumped back to the other screen, and so I was like, maybe, because I know that they update the setup stuff as well, so maybe they updated the process so it has better recognition of it. Now, I don't think I have SLI turned on at the moment. So, it might be... As I know on Final Fantasy, there's a weird, weird issue where it's like, SLI, NVIDIA, multi-monitor, SLI, and Final Fantasy all together at the same time,
mm-hmm.
bad things happen.
Mm-hmm.
Something doesn't work right. And I have the potentials for that, but I typically avoided it because I don't have my machine in SLI mode.
Yeah.
The games, my machine has ran relatively well enough that I haven't really had a overly, crazy need to actually run that. So I've been running it with it off and just using the second monitor separately so I can be doing other things on the second monitor completely separate from the game, and I'm kind of liking that. So
technically, shouldn't you be able to set things up where it will automatically enable SLI for certain games? I know with NVIDIA, with my AMD card, I can set up separate profiles
for
games.
It might be in a per-game profile option. I have not researched that.
Because I had to do that before the update to Windows 10. I had to do that for to get Knights of the Old Republic to launch on Steam. It's an older game, and you had to turn off... I believe you had to make sure that it was...
You
had to make sure VSync was off in the game.
Because my monitors are backwards to Windows' basic way it lays things out. Because my secondary monitor is to my left instead of to my right. And Windows usually assumes your second monitor is to your right.
Yeah.
So I usually have to manually flip them over in the settings.
Mm-hmm.
And I have found that sometimes when I turn it off and turn it back on, it forgets that. So, now maybe that was a Windows 7 problem. Maybe, I don't know, I haven't tried Windows 10. But that's been kind of an issue for me where the monitor's on the wrong side. Where my main desktop, I'll move over to the left.
Ah.
So, I've kind of been very itchy. I've been kind of very wary of changing that setting frequently.
Yeah.
Because I have to flip the monitors over. Well, not flip them physically over, but flip their configuration over so that the second monitor is off to the left.
Yeah.
So there's been some. That's kind of why I've avoided playing with that feature too much, too worried about breaking it.
I have not run Knights of the Old Republic on Windows 10 yet. Now it's supposed to be able to run. It's supposed to, people have been playing it on Windows 10, and of course, Knights of the Old Republic 2 recently got a patch that updates it, and it even has mod support now.
Okay.
And a lot of the older games I have some games that run in DOSBox. Those are supposed to be just fine. And then I have...
I haven't tried it yet.
Those are supposed to be fine.
I haven't tried it yet. The DOSBox. the DOS box, the whole DOS box thing where you can copy and paste without having to have the menu. Haven't tried it yet.
Those are supposed to run. Those are supposed to run just fine. And also, I have the enhanced editions of Baldur's Gate and Icewind Dale, the classic Black Isle D&D RPGs. And those are updated for modern PCs. Those ran under Windows 7, so those should have no issues with Windows 10. I haven't run into anything that just absolutely will not work.
Yeah, I haven't either. Most of the stuff I've had has... There's been some occasional oddity, but generally everything seems to be working smooth. And that's because, I think for me, I just skipped Windows 8. It's like every other version of Windows. Windows XP was great, skip Vista. Windows 7's great, skip 8. Windows 10, even if they screw with the numbering of Windows all the time.
We never used it. Now, we did do support for your aunt who had Windows 8 on her laptop.
Yeah.
I did more with it than you did. And
that's probably because I was like, Mike can fix this. I don't want to touch this thing.
And it was bad. I mean, it was bad. It's Windows 10. It's snappy. It feels faster. It just feels faster.
Windows 8 was sort of another Vista in another way.
You know, about that, they skipped version 9. They went all the way to 10. They went from 8.1 to 10. And people have been wondering, what happened to Windows 9? Why did they skip Windows 9?
Mm-hmm.
Was there a version in between that they were working on and dropped?
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's been this thing that's been going on called the every other version of Windows curse. And it's like
every... It's been true, though!
Yes, it's been true. It has... Been true, and it has been consistent.
You gotta realize, I got to play with Windows 3.0.
Yeah.
Long time ago. It sucked. It had issues. It was a problem. Then there was Windows 3.1, which was really another version. I mean, it looked the same, but it was a whole different animal under the hood.
Mm-hmm.
And so it worked. And then they had Windows 95.
Well, there was, between there was Windows 3.1.1.
There was 3.1.1, but that was only just a network add-on.
Yeah.
That was all that was really added.
True.
It was still the same operating system. They just plugged in more network features.
Windows that was, for work groups.
That was mostly because of Windows NT.
Yeah.
But once then you had Windows 95, which was kind of a mishmash accident of old and new.
Yeah.
Then Windows 95, or actually no, Windows 98, which was great. We used 98 for ages and ages and ages and ages. Then we had Windows ME. That was another accident.
It was 95, and that was okay. That it had its issues, but it wasn't bad. People really liked it. 98
was the keeper for a long time.
98 had a lot of issues.
It had a lot of issues, but it worked.
Which is why they had to do Windows 98 second edition.
Yeah, I mean, it was still, they just had to patch it up.
Yeah.
I mean, but we used it for so long. I mean, it was kind of it was not perfect yet. They had not, I mean, there were issues, but compared to the Windows 95 and Windows ME on either that were flanking it, yeah, you wanted to use 98.
That was around the time that they released the first USB.
That's where it ran into big trouble.
And Windows 98 just had all kinds of issues with it. And then they released second edition and worked fine.
Yeah, then you had Windows XP, which was the mainstay for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And then you had Windows Vista, which was... Can we skip Vista? Yeah, this is what we're talking about.
God, I used Vista. I had Vista on my laptop. It was awful. You weren't missing anything. It was clunky. It was slow.
Yeah, and then Windows 7, which we've all come to know. And then Windows 8. And then Windows 10. So, I mean, comparatively,
Windows 7 was basically what Windows Vista should have been.
That's what they were headed toward.
And then Windows 10, I think the reason why the development was so quick is it hasn't really been that long since Windows 8 first shipped.
I was amazed at how fast they turned that
around. It's been several years.
The intermediary versions are not very long. If you look at the Windows 95 versus 98, 98 was all around for a lot longer. And when you look at how quickly we got past Emmy, and then you look how fast we got past Wint Vista, usually what's happening is there's a stable edition of Windows, and then there's this beta version of what's coming that's a hybrid of what was and what's going to be. If you look at all these intermediate versions that we say are bad, what you see is a hybrid of what was and what's going to be, because on the Windows NT side, you had Windows NT 3.1, which was basically interface-wise like Windows... There was a 3.5, or I forget the version number exactly. There was a version of Windows prior to Windows 4. I think it was 3-something. I want to say 3.5, but it's been a long time. That looked like Windows... That looked just like Windows 3.1.
Yeah.
And then there was this version of Windows... There was Windows 4.0, which very much looked like Windows 95. Very much so. I mean, it was very 95. But it was the technology that was going to become XP.
Yeah.
And then Windows 2000, which was truly what the birth of XP. Windows 2000 truly was the beginning. That's where XP came from, out of Windows 2000.
A lot of businesses used it for a long time.
I used it for a while, for a certain project.
Windows ME mimicked its look and behavior, but it was still the Win 9X kernel.
What Windows 2000 was, Windows 2000 was a Windows NT kernel.
Yeah.
Windows ME was the graphical changes that were coming.
Yeah, it mimicked the look and feel of Windows 2000, but it was still the...
No, Windows 2000 didn't have the look.
Windows ME had the look of Windows 2000, but it was still the Win 9X kernel.
No, wait. The Windows 2000 mimicked the 95 look. It was a technology change, not a graphics change. I've used it.
That's well, I was talking about Windows ME and Windows 2000.
Right, this is what I'm talking about. Windows 2000 did not have a new look. It still had. No. I remember. It still had the Windows. Windows NT 4.0 look, the Windows 95 style interface, that's all it had. It didn't have a lot of new features graphically.
Well, it was still somewhat reskinned a little bit to make it look a little different.
Nope, it was the same.
I used Windows 2000 when I was in the IT department of one company.
It was about the same. I mean, I used it. I've still got a copy if you want to see it. I've used it. But the Windows ME side had all the 95 core.
Yeah.
It was all 95 just reskinned completely. Those two is where they were headed to XP. Once we got to XP, that's when they took the technology that was Windows and Windows 2000 and the graphical changes that were coming from Windows ME, and that was the birth of kind of what led to what we have today, and they've just reskinned and retooled it for the most part, but it's pretty much been that merger ever since.
Yeah.
And they've basically, the only difference between the server editions and the business editions and the home editions have all been just which features are turned on and which features are turned off. That's been that ever since. Once they merged that old NT core with the old 95 stuff, once they merged them at Windows XP, it's been that ever since. They've simplified it. And I could be still missing a few things, and I could still be wrong, but that's what I remember.
Miracle One. Thing that they had trouble with Windows 2000 was getting DirectX to work right. And that's the reason why they went with Windows ME.
They were trying to get... it was one of the things that you had to realize with Windows NT 4 is they had what's called an abstraction layer. What's called HAL.
The HAL.
Hardware Abstraction Layer. Back in the day, their intention was to keep Windows as stable as possible. Mm-hmm. And their goal for that was to... get so that all the hardware, all of it was operating system controlled. That if you wanted to do something with the hardware, you had to go through the operating system and request permissions, otherwise you couldn't touch hardware at all. That was their goal. What they discovered was that was a massive bottleneck for certain types of applications. Mm-hmm. Real-time applications like games and other things that needed extremely fast access to the hardware, they were in the way. And there was no way to put an abstraction layer in there without creating delay. That any time they added any kind of checking at all, it would slow it down. So what they were doing in Windows 2000, what I was talking about, was they were pulling back the HAL. They were redesigning that hardware layer so that so that applications had that faster access. Yeah. They were building that into it. So it had more functionality. It could do more. That's where I had that video editing software. That's why it could work the way it did.
Yeah.
It required Windows 2000 in order to have that functionality. Because it needed that HAL level stripped back a little bit so they could get direct access. In fact, the graphics card and the capture card actually talked to each other directly on the bus. There were layers of interface between them two at the driver level where they were specifically communicating with each other and sharing information back and forth. It was a pretty amazing setup that they got that to work.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, that's what they were working on, and then that got built into XP, and then the graphical changes, the UI, the way the windows would look, the way they would do different things, and then they added the Lua interface on top of that, where we got that blue start menu, that green start menu button, and the blue taskbar type of look. They were starting to play with the interface even more than what they had in Windows 95.
I always turned that off.
Yeah, I did too. It looked terrible. It looked pretty awful.
It looked terrible, and also I noticed that it did degrade performance slightly.
It detracted from everything. I don't think they really got interface element redesigned properly, I don't think, until Windows 7.
Yeah.
And that where the GUI was more integrated into it as far as the functionality of, like, what's it called where you had the transparencies and stuff? What's the name?
Arrow.
Arrow, yeah.
Now, this doesn't have Arrow. Windows 8.1 got rid of Arrow. Windows 8.1 and Windows 10 doesn't have it. Now, they still have desktop compositing, but it's not a separate process. It's a part of the desktop now. It can't be turned off. Not like Windows 7 where you're running a certain application and then, boom, you...
I am wondering if that's going to come back to bite us. And I'll tell you why I think this.
Yeah.
I saw something for the first time that I had not seen in quite some time.
Yeah.
When I was picking the weeds out of my computer,
mm-hmm.
for the first time in a long time, Task Manager was not responding. And that was the first time I had seen that in a long time with the Task Manager. Usually you had to hose something pretty tight for your Task Manager to get mulled. And so that was one of the experiences I was having, was where Task Manager was sort of really freaking out. Another side effect of this as well is when something integrates and locks in with that, like, for example, I like to have black background with white text because it hurts my eyes after a while. And over so many white windows, I just was having a hard time seeing. And getting the magnifier feature to work again, like I had in I almost uninstalled it because I couldn't find it. I finally found the options to turn on the enabling feature of the inversion.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lag now. When that starts up, it doesn't just start up. There's a lag where the mouse is noticeably jerking around and not functional while it's trying to tie into the desktop.
No, I didn't install it, but I found a Chrome extension that will do high contrast.
Well, I need it for all the windows. I mean, there are so many windows that are just plain white. A lot of the Windows settings screens and other option screens. The nice thing was, I had the icon for the old magnifier option on my desktop when I switched over. Those icons are still there. That icon still functions.
Yeah.
So, and it still works the same way. So the functionality remained the same. I was amazed that it's managed to transition over. The only caveat to it was that there's this weird delay when I app. It's not when I switch, turn it on and off, like with the hotkey. It's when I run the application or close it. There's a delay.
Yeah.
And which is new. That wasn't there before. I don't know if I press Ctrl-Alt-Delete if it does. I haven't remember. I don't think it does the weird thing where it goes into a window mode. Where if I have the magnifier running and I hit Ctrl-Alt-Delete, it will suddenly split off into this window where the compositing disappears. I think that's a sign of the fact that it's all together now.
Yeah. Also, I don't know if it does what Windows 7 and XP did, where if you control-alt-delete, it goes to this full screen view, and then you have these links to choose.
Oh, it still does that. But yeah. it doesn't seem to drop out of the GUI like it did before. In order, you don't drop out of the area or its version of whatever that is. It doesn't drop out of that in order for that to come up.
Hmm. Now, one thing I liked is I have my background. and I had it set to where it got the color scheme from my wallpaper.
I had the option for that, but the color scheme was really weird looking because I've got a very dark background. I've got the Heaven's Word banner on mine, so the color scheme it was wanting to choose was a little weird, so I didn't like it.
I think Grab's the most predominant color, so it was a sort of a blue for mine.
Yeah, I think it was trying to make mine black because the predominant color in it's more black than anything else. More darker colors, and you'd think that'd be better, but it was coming up with oranges and stuff. I was like,
and now for our final thoughts. Well, I think Windows 10 is a move in the right direction for Microsoft. It didn't work out for them when they wanted to force-feed a touch interface to people with Windows 8.1. It was just the wrong move. They were desperate to get into mobile, and it showed. And they did it in a very haphazard, very heavy-handed way, and it just wasn't right, and people didn't like it. You know, Windows 8.1 had its fans, but most people didn't like it, so they stuck with Windows 7. I think this is a good move. It's not a backtrack. A lot of people saying that it's just Microsoft backtracking from what they were trying to do. I think this is the right decision to make it to where you can use it as a regular desktop operating system, and then you have the option of turning on touch interface if you have a touch interface. And it automatically switches back and forth if you have a phablet, which is a tablet that works like a laptop when it's docked to a keyboard. This reflects a lot of the other changes that have been happening to Microsoft ever since Steve Ballmer left and Satya Nadella took over. There's been a lot of positive changes with the company. You know, yes, they've been laying off a lot of people. I think they've been getting rid of a lot of the older people that are less flexible. They have been hiring new people. They got rid of the whole Nokia division and ate like $3 billion from that. But they're still committed to their phone division. But I think this is a positive change. They're open sourcing more software like .NET and their SDK for creating iOS applications. And I think this is a better Microsoft than what they have been. There's still a lot of work to be done, still a lot of changes to be done. I mean, it's even happening in the Xbox division. You're seeing a lot of positive changes happening there. And so I think it's a good move, and Windows 10 reflects that.
I think I'm pretty much in agreement with what you've said there. Overall, I think Microsoft, I pretty much would agree with what you were saying. I think as long as they move forward with what the users, the biggest thing I noticed in the fiasco, especially when it came to Windows 8 and where they were moving to 10, was paying attention to what the needs of their users are. Because, you know, we're their customers, we use their products every day. And I think keeping track of what the customer really needs. It's a business. It's like, what does the customer's needs are? What do the customers want? And staying focused on what their customers' needs and desires are, I think is going to be key for them going forward. And getting that user feedback, having the users, open source is great, that way they can get feedback from a development side, but also paying attention to what the general audience needs are. You know, the mom and pop users out there who just want a desktop that functions and just want to use their computer and don't know how it works. They just want to be able to do, you know, their Facebooks or their internets or whatever. And, you know, being able to collect better feedback like, okay, I've got a problem with this app. It doesn't do what I want it to do. Like, for example, the news app I talked about earlier. Having it so that, you know, they can collect that kind of feedback better. And I've seen components in there where it does ask now. And this is a good trend. This is a good thing where they're saying, is this doing what you need it to do? And so that's the right track. So I think I agree that in general, moving forward, as long as they're staying focused on what their customers need, they'll make better products.
Hope you enjoyed the show. Geektastic Weekly will be a bi-weekly program discussing the latest news in entertainment, games, and technology. If you liked what you heard, please consider subscribing and hitting that like button. See you next time.